Michael Norris, and this is The Art of Thinking Smart. David Chang is normally the host, but I'm substituting as host today. My name is Michael North, and we're coming to you from beautiful downtown Honolulu in the Pioneer Plaza, where it's a sunny day, perfect weather again. We had several days of almost hurricane-type weather and all kinds of traffic and chaos, but now we're back to the normal mid-Pacific perfection. And we have a young lady here with us today who's really one of the leading lights in Honolulu society with respect to organizing for great causes, for nonprofit organizations. She has a long background in media and communications, and she's put that professional experience to work on a number of boards and as an executive and as a staff person in various nonprofit organizations and foundations around Honolulu. So this is one person, Sheila O'Keefe, who has decided to use her considerable talents to give back to society, to give back to the world. And I've worked with Sheila, I've seen the results of her work. I know the organizations that she serves and greatly admire what has been achieved. So today I wanted to probe a little bit under the surface with Sheila to understand how she does it, how organizing happens with a person like Sheila O'Keefe. You know, everybody has to juggle multiple balls. And Sheila, you were telling us that your late husband,
yes,
told you one day when you had been in a particularly intense phase that, Sheila, you've done it again. You've organized yourself into oblivion.
Yes.
So I was caught by that. By that expression. What did he mean? Was that a good thing?
Well, thank you, first of all, for inviting me to come on the show this
Our
afternoon.
Pleasure. Thank you. Mahalo.
Thank you. And I think it was both a loving jibe at me and also maybe a little creative and, you know, kind of a criticism, but with, you know, a good heart. Mm-hmm. And I do have a tendency to sometimes over-organize, and then it does seem like it sort of blows up again because it's so organized that it's just gotten so small as far as the levels of organization that then it just becomes too mixed up. So, but, you know, I think overall I don't consider myself an expert in organizing, but I think I do have some good organizational skills, and I'm not a linear thinker, so I really enjoy having a lot of ideas and having a lot of things rolling and things up in the air and whatnot. But you do have to focus in on what it is you really are trying to achieve and to try to keep that foremost in your mind, I think, when you come to your personal organization. And you had a very interesting thing that you said one of your mentors said to you. Would you share that with us?
Yeah, one of my mentors said, you know, in real estate, they say there's only one word that's important, and that's location. And in organizing and in management, there's the most important word is no. So what do you think of that? There, no and oblivion seem to somehow connect there, but I think there's something different meant there. What, do you agree with that, that no is an important word, and why?
Well, you know, it's funny because I did take some notes before I came on and I was trying to crystallize my thoughts a little, be organized. Mm. And I think it's easier to know what you don't like than it is sometimes to know what it is you like or what it is you want or what it is you're really trying to achieve. It's very clear, we don't want that. No, you can't do that. No, we don't want to go that direction. Mm-hmm. Whatever those kinds of no's may be, I think are important sometimes because it helps then crystallize, or it helps frame where you really want to go with your organization. And I think it can be helpful, but it's sometimes hurtful and hard for an employee, a staff member, a junior staff member to hear, no, we don't want to do that. So I think you do need to temper that with compassion and kindness. Yeah. And, you know, and as we all need to do in our life, in our work life, whatnot.
Yeah, I think what my mentor meant was, let's say you have an event that has a bunch of different parts to it.
Right.
It has a reception, it has a banquet, it has a performance, it has a post-party to it, it has a discussion, a forum, it's being broadcast live or recorded. All those are big moving parts, right? It has a celebrity that's appearing. And at some point, an organizer might need to say no to one of those components, might need to say no to the after party.
Right.
Even though the after party has plenty of justification in itself.
Right.
But would you agree that in that sense, you need to define yourself as to what your capabilities, what your limitations are?
Yes, I do totally agree with that. And having done a lot of events, some of them almost as complicated as the one that you just described,
yeah.
I would say that knowing what you are going to do and saying, no, we really can't do that, is very important.
Yeah.
And I think it really does, once again, it helps bring clarity to the project, and you don't have a tendency then to go off and try to do too much and really not be able to achieve anything of high substance or high quality. And, you know, I know in our experience in working with the Iona Contemporary Dance Company and the Nova Arts Foundation, we often struggle with saying no because we want to do so much, because we love what we do and we love our product, if you will, our creative dance company. And so it oftentimes makes it difficult for us to say no. And so I think probably at that point, you know, we have to look at budget. And not only the budget financially, but also the budget as far as the people power and the labor that we have to be able to achieve everything we want to want to do. And I think really one of the keys of that no process is then once you've made that decision, getting everyone on board with it and making sure that they're okay with it, because sometimes people may still have a desire to do something and really want to somehow make it happen even though it's not going to happen or not going to happen easily, let's say.
Maybe sometimes the answer is no, not yet.
Yes.
So it's yes, but.
Right. Right.
Which amounts to a no in the immediate situation, but next year we'll put more attention on the after party and we'll plan around that.
That's right.
Right. You don't want to stifle creativity, but you don't want to lose your focus either.
Absolutely not. Absolutely. And I think, you know, that's the one of the beauty parts of the no is that as you become more comfortable with knowing yourself and what your capabilities are and understanding what the capabilities of your organization are, a no, like you say, is not necessarily a no forever. It may just be not now, not yet, not during this event, but going forward, let's talk about it, or let's bring it back at some other point
in
and talk about
form,
it again.
Perhaps.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Well, defining yourself by the negative is one part of it, right? But I think that it's important to define yourself by the positive, because then the negative will become clear, right?
Yes.
So every successful organization that I've been part of has 3 to maximum 5 principles, mission, elements of the mission statement, right?
Right.
Which anybody from a volunteer who shows up for the first time to a board member who's been on the board for 20 years can keep in their head easily.
Right.
So would you agree that having that kind of a very clear, simple principle is important.
I think it is, and I do believe that it helps us to be able to convey our message when we are able to have that elevator speech, so that when we meet somebody for the first time or maybe meet them again, we're able to communicate effectively what our mission is for our organization. And please don't ask me what Iona's is. No, because you know it's so wonderful and it's so broad, and it is to really tap into that creative spirit and to, and you're such a great spokesperson. You know, I'm a better wordsmith when I'm sitting down at my computer. Mm. When I find myself speaking sometimes in public, I struggle for words sometimes. So, and I love your ability to just
thank you.
Blow it out, so.
Yeah, for those who might be curious, Iona that we're referring to is the Iona Contemporary Dance Theater. You can find them online at iona360.com. And both Sheila and I serve on the board. And this is Hawaii's most outstanding, just flat out amazing creative dance company, headed by a genius from Kailua, Cheryl Flaherty, who's able to produce visions in dance and choreography and lighting and costumes and so on that are absolutely intoxicating, and that address key issues like women, like the environment, like the life of other species on the planet other than humanity. Those are three recent themes.
Yes.
Another one was water, just the whole the water of life.
Right.
And she's able to create an evening length work about a subject as abstract as water and make you laugh and cry and gasp and so on.
Right.
So if anybody has a chance to check out Iona 360, there's performances that come up from time to time, and they are flat out amazing.
They are.
And there is, I think, well, I know Cheryl's principles are listen to the community, listen to the soul of the community.
Yes.
Not just the voices, but what people are really caring about.
Right.
That's like responsiveness.
Yes.
You know, number one is quality, an absolute obsession with quality from the smallest detail of the tiniest feather on the a costume to the sand, to the lighting, to the acrobatics, to every angle, and she will go back and forth over that every detail until it's polished like a diamond.
Right.
And the final one I would say is Cheryl's forte, and that really any business or any nonprofit could profit from looking at these is heart.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
The sense that there's a connection from the soul of a person that's reaching out to others. It's not just communicating information, it's communicating meaning and heart.
Right.
And that's something that's really important in an organization that you've participated in, which is Planned Parenthood.
Yes.
And we'll come to that after we take a brief break.
Okay. Aloha kakou. I'm Marcia Joyner, and I'm inviting you to navigate the journey. We are discussing the end-of-life options, and we would really love to have you every Wednesday morning at 11 a.m. right here.
You're watching ThinkTech on ThinkTechHawaii.com, which broadcasts six live talk shows from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. every weekday, and then we stream our earlier shows all night long and on the weekends, too. Great content for Hawaii from ThinkTech.
Thank you for watching ThinkTech. I'm Grace Chang, the new host for Global Connections. You can find me here live every Thursday at 1 p.m., where we'll be talking to people around the islands or visiting the islands who are connected in various aspects of global affairs. So please tune in, and aloha, and thanks for watching.
So we're back live here with Sheila O'Keefe. And Sheila, I want to ask you about Planned Parenthood. It's an organization that you've had a very prominent role to play with. And you've been an organizer, and you've been an interpreter, and so on, of the meaning of that, the importance of that organization. tell us a little bit about, let's say you're 6 months away from a really big event that you're planning.
Okay.
It's gonna be a fundraiser, a public, a something, there's gonna be news, there's gonna be issues and right. fireworks or right. whatever you're, how do you begin to organize that in your mind even 6 months out before even talking about it with anybody? And what are the stages you go through okay. until the moment that the microphone switches on?
Right, right. Thank you. And first of all, I have to preface anything I say as I am not a representative spokesperson for Planned Parenthood here today. I am really here as a private and public citizen, and I'm just sharing my thoughts on organizational
yeah.
activities. And to me, the first and foremost thing that we need to do is we need to look at what is the purpose of the event that we're going to be doing, and there again, that goes to the more positive thing. Do we, you know, we may have a dollar figure associated with it, but we also may have a heart piece associated with it. We may want to make sure that we're touching the hearts of our audience members and that we're allowing them an opportunity to learn something or support something, to share their values, to support their values. And I think that anything that that I've been associated with in my lifetime has always had some value component to it, mm-hmm. whether that be the arts or whether it be a social service organization.
So does that crystallize in a name or a theme that you
sometimes it can. Sometimes yeah. it can, but often I think people also want to have a good time sometimes. They just want to get together and talk with mm-hmm. Their fellows and see people that maybe they haven't seen for a year mm-hmm. from the last time that they all were at the event or the last time they were all at a performance. Mm-hmm. And so, for instance, shameless plug, Planned Parenthood will be having an event coming up on February 18th, so I'm only about 3.5 weeks out from that. Mm-hmm. And we're calling it an evening with Planned Parenthood Ohana. So that is just a lovely phrase, you know, and we will have some wonderful speakers, and it will be a chance for our Ohana to get together. So what we've done is we have a work plan, we have committees, we're working on all of the different aspects of how we're going to produce the event, the venue, and the format of the program, printed materials that we'll have there. So there are, you know, just a list this long of things that need to be taken care of, and so I've worked on these kinds of things for years and have just sort of like this checklist or punch list, you know, that yeah. you would see in construction. This needs to be done, this needs to be done, and mm-hmm. put a date with it, and sometimes you don't
and
hit that date.
That template works across multiple events. You have to
sure.
customize it
sure.
each time.
Sure, but absolutely. And for instance, with the church that I work with, the Unitarian Church, mm-hmm. we also will be having a fundraiser coming up at the end of April, mm-hmm. and so we're now just getting into that real push to get those plans formalized and put together, and so we'll also have that same sort of a work back plan, some people call it, or a work plan,
yeah.
Where you have the date and you know, okay, the day before you're going to have to do this, or the day of you're going to have to do all this stuff, and then the day before you have to, you know,
yeah.
and in theatrical presentation, dance presentation, live, you know, performance, mm. Those lists are, that's your Bible, that's what you live by, that's how you know what you're doing, you know, and same thing with Unitarians or Planned Parenthood people or Iona people. Or
it sounds like you're a big time delegator, and that's probably a big part of your skill, is to know what you need to control and where you need to release control.
Well, I'm glad that it looks like that from the outside, but I do have a tendency to hold too many things together sometimes. And
right. That's where the oblivion thing came
exactly.
in.
Exactly. So, you know, I am always challenged with delegating. And it's not so much a matter of trust, but sometimes it is. It's not that I don't trust that person to do the job, but I sometimes find that maybe I haven't communicated it effectively, so they may not know. And then here comes that no word. I'll go, no, that's not really what we wanted, or, you know, and that can sometimes be troublesome when you're working with a lot of volunteers, which I do. Yeah. So I think the important thing is to try to delegate and find people early on that will take on the responsibilities of different aspects and just give them a lot of support and be, you know, in my work life, I am their staff support. So I have to help them create the documents, or I have to help them get the mailing done, or I have to do something, you know, on that
so
staff level.
So there's a push-pull of accountability.
Sure.
Between the manager and the...
So I think I just finish.
Sure.
One thought. I think part of the reason why I've always been an organizer, and maybe I'm not so good at delegation, is that I was the oldest child of a large family. And so I was always organizing the kids and getting things going and, you know, here, we're going to do this. And then in the neighborhood, we would, you know, get together and let's put on a show. And, you know, and then later when I got into my professional life and I was a video producer and we did a small video movie, I had to, you know, bring together hundreds of people, volunteers, you know, and say, okay, gang, everybody run over there and look like you're scared, you know, or whatever it is, you know. And so I sometimes don't delegate as much as I should, but I am always challenged with it and I'm always working to be better at it.
I'm sure there's a constant dynamic. And you know, I've worked with some very alpha type personalities, organizers, managers, observed, you know, Steve Jobs, for example, observed Bill Gates, who are two prototypical alpha controlling there at the center of the web.
Right.
Also worked with two big organizations, IBM and Hewlett Packard, whose culture is entirely different from that.
Right.
They always have a strong CEO, but his or her job is to disperse the responsibility through a network.
Right.
And I think it's important for any organization, whether it's nonprofit or a business, to recognize what its identity is and what its the strength of its people really is.
Yes.
And because if you have a very strong, organizing, inspirational person at the center, you don't want to force them to disperse their energy out through a great many people.
Right.
But if you have an organizational culture that is more sort of bottom up, then you don't want to put a star at the center of it and frustrate them.
Right.
So this is something that I think anybody who's watching this program and thinking about their own business, whether it be selling lemonade or selling cell phones, could take some inspiration from that thought.
That's right. And I like the idea of when you do find a star, helping to support them to be that star. And I've always enjoyed actually being that sort of second level, not really being the spokesperson, not really being the president. I'm much better at sort of, as I was in my family, I think, you know. My parents were the leaders and I was sort of the general underneath, you know, and or the major or whatever. You know, I'm not good with military, you know, hierarchies, but
a pyramid type.
Yeah. You know, there's the leader you know, and so one of the issues that I think that right now my Unitarian Church is having is that we don't have a minister. We've been a very much volunteer-driven and congregational-driven organization since we lost our beloved minister about a year and a half ago. He left to move to California for family reasons. And It's been a very interesting dynamic, what's been going on. And sometimes it's hard for us to know who the leader is. We do have a president, and but she gets a lot of flack from, you know, from the other supporters. And much like on Survivor, you know, that television show, right. If somebody comes forward and sort of takes the lead, they become the target, you know? Yeah. So a lot of times it's better not to be the forefront and to sort of be in the background trying to support things, or come on, gang, let's all get involved with this, you know?
And I hear you speak about that. As you know, I'm a little bit of a student of Chinese philosophy.
Yes.
My wife is from Beijing,
yes.
So I study China through her. Her personality reflects the whole nation and culture to me. And you know, the Tao Te Ching is the foundational document in that culture. And Lao Tzu says, when the job of the great leader is complete, the people say, we did it ourselves.
Oh, that's fabulous.
From that point of view, the leader is unknown. The leader is invisible.
Right.
Nobody even really knows.
Right.
Who did it? It happened by natural evolutionary force.
Right.
And that's a very different model from the Steve Jobs, I'm going to tell you exactly where to put the logo kind of thing.
Exactly. Yeah. And you know what? Just recently we had that Women's March all across the country in Washington.
Yeah.
And that was sort of almost a leaderless kind of a thing. There were leaders, but they were almost tapped or asked to get involved after the fact, after there was like this groundswell of, we want to do this, you know? And and I think just people came together and decided, well, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to help, and I'm going to do whatever I need to do.
Self-organizing.
Exactly.
And viral and social media. And that is an option for us.
Yes.
Okay, we're getting close to the end of our program, and I want to make sure that you have a chance to tell us, first of all, about the Planned Parenthood event in February.
Okay.
Tell us, you said it's February the 18th?
Yes, it is. It's a Saturday night.
Where's that taking place?
February 18th. It will be in the downtown area at the Pacific Guardian Center.
Ah.
And it's in the courtyard area. It starts at 5:30 p.m. And people are welcome to look us up online at ppgnhi.org. And as I say, I'm really not here as a spokesperson. I really wasn't trying to push the Planned Parenthood thing. But
that's part of your job.
Thank you so much.
And the Unitarian Church. Tell us about that.
Well, that'll be, I believe the date is going to be April 21st. And it will be an event at our church. We'll have a silent auction. We'll have entertainment. We'll have food and wine. And, you know, the Unitarians love their wine and coffee. But it will be a very nice event. And
thank
the
you,
Unitarian Church is on the Pali. And so not to be confused with Unity Church.